Video enhancement scenes are common in Hollywood movies and TV crime series. Just enhance that image, says the actor to a fictional technician, and voila, suddenly you see that blurred face become clear as day. That's fiction, of course, but can Topaz Video Enhance AI reproduce this in some real and useful way? Well, in this video, you'll find out. So stick around because I'm going to show you the various options and details of how Topaz Video Enhance AI works. I'm Bruce McBride and I can provide one-on-one tuition in Final Cut over the internet. We'll share your screen. Just click in the link below, trainingfinalcutpro.com. There are three fairly distinct uses for the Topaz enhancing software, from updating old 720p SD footage to something respectable in 1080p, and this will work with even older VHS camera footage. And the second is upscaling 1080p to 4K or even 8K, and the third is to extract clear still images from HD footage and even SD footage. I'll give you an overview of this later in the video. There's another tutorial specifically covering single frame enhancement. Click the eye above. But for this video, I'm going to mainly concentrate on recovering old SD footage or 720p footage into a usable 1080p video. And at the time of production for this video, the Mac version of Topaz is a recent release. And the first thing that a Mac user will notice is the interface looks a little bit like a PC. I'm not saying this inhibits the software, just making the observation. When you first launch the software, there's a flash screen as a welcome to Topaz Video Enhance AI. This shows you three steps to get going in an auto mode. And you have the choice of retaining this screen for future launch, or you could turn it off for future startups. Close that and we'll look at the interface, which will give you more of an idea of what we're doing as we progress through the enhancements. It appears that Topaz will open any format you throw at it. I've tried AVI, M4V, WMV, DIVX, MP4 and MOV. So now let's drag a file and you'll see that that appears in the bottom of the screen. At the very bottom, you can see the path from where that comes from and where it's actually going to be recorded to, though we'll see that in a minute. I'm also going to drag in an already processed clip so you can see the difference immediately. And this one here is the original clip, pre-processing, and this one has already been processed. And you can see how clear the text is there. It's even sharper than the original there. You can see how there's some dirty marks in the original. And also this one has been upscaled as well. So let's look at those three steps and where we can change them. The first one that we're looking at is the processing heading. And you'll see that there's some AI models here to choose from. And as you click on each of these, you get some information about them. This one here, you would certainly use for your low quality footage, and this one here for your higher quality footage. And I also find these two here work quite well also. With all that said, these various models don't immediately jump out and tell you which one to use. So what I suggest you do is to drag two versions or more of the same clip into this area here, and then you can try different settings for those two versions. So to be clear, I would use this here for your SD and your 720p footage. I'd use the HQ for 1080p originals that are going to 4K and 8K. And you might also notice that these models here, that's the detail and the fidelity models, will also allow you to set your own sharpening, deblock and noise reduction. Next we have the settings heading. And there are a number of presets in here. The 100% is at the same size as the original, but it will also denoise and deblock. Sometimes in videos, you'll notice that the compression has caused the sky or the blue sky to band. So rather than being a nice smooth grade between a darker blue and a lighter blue, you've got bandings of the different colors. So what this 100% setting does is it doesn't upscale, it simply reduces any banding or deblock, and it also denoises or takes that graininess out of the videos. You then have 200 and 400% of the current format or whatever your original format is, or you can ask for 4K or 8K. The HD will give you 1920 by 1080, so you would use that if you were coming up from an SD footage. You could also use 4K and 8K settings to upgrade from your standard or SD settings. So I guess that there's going to be so little information in your SD footage that the 4K and the 8K is just going to give you a plastic looking image. My tip for when you're using these settings is not to go above 1920 for your SD original footage and 4K for 720p original footage. For really small SD footage, maybe stick to the 720p output. And definitely deinterlace any footage before you bring it in to be enhanced. The interlacing lines will just be exaggerated if you try to upscale. And this is the sort of thing that you may be confronted with when you're looking at old footage. I've got this 1980 band reunion concert, which was filmed on a VHS camera. There's a full video on showing how to use this process. Just click the eye above. So just in the meantime, we'll pick a point in the footage and we'll take a preview of that. Then that will preview for a few seconds and then loop. We can stop that process there and we can look at the original footage here. Now we're using the 100% here, so there's no upscaling. And here, if you look at the face and the face here, then they're slightly increased over here. And because there's so little detail in the faces, it really hasn't got a lot to work on. But in these more smoother areas underneath the keyboard here, then you can see that that's quite fuzzy there and this is much sharper here. And you'll also notice in the wording here, it says illusion there, reunion show, and it's much clearer here on the right-hand side that has been processed and enhanced. I'm using the Artemis LQ model because this is low quality video with a high noise and a high compression. For original 1080p footage, I would go up to 4K rather than 8K unless you're prepared for very long processing time. I mean hours, because rendering a 4K upscale can take up to 5 seconds per frame. And for a 1 hour video at 50 frames per second, then that's 5 minutes for every second of video. You do the math. And at the end of the day, I've found that 4K upscaling, that's less than 1 second per frame, is barely noticeably different than 8K. And since most televisions these days don't go to 8K, then there's probably little call for it at the moment anyway. It'll all depend on your computer's processing power as to how long it takes the process to happen. And to give you some idea on these tests, I'm running a 2020 iMac. It's a 3.8 gigahertz 8-core i7 processor with 64 gigabyte of memory and with the Radeon Pro 5700 XT and 2 terabytes of SD storage. And if I ask this one to be processed now, this is the starting point. We want to make sure which video we have ticked and what our starting point is in the timeline. So clicking this now and it will start to process. And you can see here that there's 4 hours, 50 minutes, around about 10 seconds per frame. Now let's look at how you will save your enhancement. You can select the format MP4 or MOV, which is ProRes HD quality and size, and then there are these 4 single image selections. The single image frame sequences will need to be stitched together in a video editor. I'll show you how to do this. Press the eye above. The MP4 and the MOV allow you to retain the audio. The 16-bit uncompressed TIFF appears to give the best results, but will severely affect your rendering times, and that depends on your need for quality. I've rendered a 1080p video to 8K using the 16-bit uncompressed sequence, and I'll show you how to get that into Final Cut for editing and stitching the single frames together at the end of this video. But since this video is about SD and 720p, let's stick to MP4 as the output. MOV will create much higher file sizes for what appears to be no real noticeable difference. Anyway, moving on to the rest of the interface. At the top left of your screen, the preview will show you the different choices in size. So on the left-hand side, you have the original size of the clip, and on the right, the enhancement and the upscale appropriate to that. You can select different sizes here to see the results. You can move through the video one frame at a time, backwards or forwards, and you can scrub as well. This here shows you the frame that it's parked on and the number of frames in the total video. These two boxes here show you where your scissors are, and your scissors are used for trimming. So if you wanted to start your video from this point, you'd click the left-hand frame to start it there, and then move on here and click the right-hand frame, and then that portion will be previewed by pressing this button here. And the preview takes a few frames of the video, and then it loops through. You can then stop that at a particular frame to view the difference, and that's when you'd use the different preview settings here. You can stop the preview process by pressing the stop button on the right, and then you're ready to start the enhancement. At this stage, you can tick whichever of the batch that you want to be processed, and this button here starts the processing. And now you can see that this particular selection from here to here is going to take 15 minutes. It's currently doing that at 1.65 seconds per frame. And each of these videos is saved to a separate file, and by default it goes to the folder where the original came from. You have, of course, the choice of selecting your own location. But before I show you the results, as I promised you how to get still frames upscaled as photos, a single frame advancement will take you to that particular frame. So I'm going to stop this process now. And if we look up here now, and let's say we want to save a particular frame, we can advance to the frame we want to stop at, which is this one here, and we can press the scissors. And then we advance one more frame and press the end scissors. Now you've selected one frame. You can then ask for that to be processed. I'll show you this in detail in another video, and press the eye above to view that. And as I promised, I'll also show you how to stitch together that 16-bit sequence. You can see here that it's been saved into this folder, and these are the TIFF images, or the 16-bit TIFF images in that folder. There are 16,000 of them there. I've created a new library here. We're going to select a few of these clips and drag them in, and we will now select a new project. And those have now been dragged into the timeline. And now we want to select everything in the timeline. So let's select Command A. And now we want to change the duration of each of these clips. And to do that, we go to the Modify menu and we select Change Duration. And now simply type 1, and you'll see that that 1 will appear here, and press Return. And all of those clips have now been reduced to one frame. If we bring the timeline to fit in window, there they are all as one frame. And you can see the grey outline there representing the one frame. Now that these are all in the timeline, you can simply export that to whatever file format you want. So let's now have a look at some of the clips that we've been processing. Are the results worth the effort? Well, yes.
Will be your shelter.
And my arms will be your home.
And my arms will be your home.
There's a big quality difference in the enhanced video, and even more so than you first realise, because the upscaling means that when the video is played at the size of the original, then the sharpness is much better. And what about the difference in HD footage upscaled to 4K or 8K? Well, more than we can cover in this video, so check the eye above for a video about that aspect of Topaz. I hope you've enjoyed this video. Thank you for watching. Please like, subscribe, and press the bell.